emisiune realizată cu sprijinul Camerei de Comerț și Industrie a României.
Bună seara, stimați telespectatori, bună seara la o nouă ediție a Ambasador România. Am avut invitați interesanți, foarte interesanți, în ultimele ediții, din punctul meu de vedere, atât români cât și străini, și invitatul de astăzi este ambasadorul celui mai nou membru al Uniunii Europene. Din punctul meu de vedere, a durat mult prea mult negocierea cu Uniunea Europeană, merita să fie în Uniunea Europeană mult mai devreme. Am vizitat această țară și o cunosc destul de bine. Este o țară cu oameni extrem de călduroși, de primitori, cu un turism extraordinar, cu locuri minunate, despre care ne va povesti domnul ambasador mai multe, dar și cu, astăzi, o clasă politică determinată să meargă spre vest, determinată de mult să meargă spre vest, dar astăzi, ca membru al Uniunii Europene, este partea clubului în care ne aflăm cu toții. Este o țară importantă, chiar dacă mai mică decât România, pentru că a trecut prin momente grele. Așa cum România a trecut prin momente grele în 1989 și în alte momente, această țară a trecut prin momente grele pentru că atunci când Iugoslavia s-a destrămat, a fost un moment dificil pentru toate țările care s-au rupt din această conglomerat de țări și a trebuit să-și recapete securitatea, să-și recapete statul, să-și recapete siguranța și așa mai departe. Nu este ușor, însă poporul croat, pentru că despre dânsi este vorba, am vrut să las până mai târziu țara, este un popor dârz, hotărât și cunoscând personal foarte bine această țară, vă pot spune că este o țară pe care a ajuns să o iubești. Înainte de a-l prezenta pe ambasadorul Croației la București, care îi mulțumesc pentru invitație, ca și în edițiile precedente, vă mai spun dumneavoastră și celor care se uită la noi încă o dată următorul lucru. Nu uitați că nu mai sunteți singuri, dumneavoastră cetățenii României, aveți aliați importanți. Iar în ceea ce mă privește și în ceea ce privește colegii mei din Coaliția Națională pentru Modernizarea României, indiferent că sunt sindicate, patronate, ONG-uri, universități, mediu academic, veți avea un aliat puternic, indiferent că vă deranjează furtul, nedreptatea, oricare dintre supărările noastre. Nu vom fi aici doar pentru a vă asculta, așa cum s-a întâmplat până acum, ci pentru a acționa. Și am început cu energia. Vom continua. Iar celor care le este frică și acționează haotic, crezând că ne intimidează, se înșală. Furtul din banii oamenilor săraci nu mai este tolerabil. Pentru că are niște beizadele din Parlament să-și cheltuie banii aiurea. Acesta este intro-ul pe care l-am făcut în fiecare dintre ultimele ediții. Pentru că iubim România, iubesc România și nimic nu va mai rămâne nepedepsit, pentru că poporul român a suferit destul. Așa că priviți și aveți încredere în colegii mei, indiferent că sunt din sindicate, din patronate, de oriunde. Adresați-vă lor cu orice fel de problemă aveți, legată de autorități care nu respectă legea, legată de hoții, legată de mărșăvii, legată de încălcări ale legii. Suntem aici pentru dumneavoastră. Dar mă întorc la subiectul emisiunii noastre, la domnul ambasador al Croației, un ambasador tânăr și un ambasador dinamic și care din start a spus: ok, lăsăm întrebările deoparte, e o discuție liberă până la urmă. Un lucru excepțional pe care eu îl apreciez la un ambasador. Mr. Ambassador, thank you very much for accepting the invitation.
Thank you for inviting me. I'm so happy that I'm in your program. I was watching few your programs, so thank you because I'm here.
It's a pleasure for us also. We didn't had yet the Croatian ambassador. Mm-hmm. You are new for 4 months in Romania.
Yes.
And therefore it's an honor to have you. Because Croatia, as I mentioned, I'm not sure how much you understood from my Romanian, but I told our viewers that I love Croatia. It was a wonderful country I visited. And from the people to the places that you have as tourism, it's a wonderful place. The history is wonderful. What I didn't like, and I will tell you.
Please, go ahead.
What I didn't like to Croatia, and I have to ask you, were the roads. How can you drive on those small roads, which, by the way, are called ulica, like in Romania,
yes,
you know?
Yes,
we
yes.
have ulica for the yes. for the villages
yes.
In Romania. But those three, I don't know how many of our viewers were in Croatia, but the streets in Croatia are half of the streets in Romania. And you know, I was always, taken by bus mm-hmm. and visiting Croatia, including your capital, and always I was afraid until I was getting to the destination, because mm-hmm. it was very small road and our bus was so big, and mm-hmm. the roads are not like in Romania, you know,
yeah.
normal, I'm not sure if it's a normal distance, but a yeah. bigger distance. And the bigger car, with a small car or two big cars were not, mm-hmm. I mean, for me I was like, how can we not make an accident?
But let you straight to the point what you mentioned. If you, of course, things are pretty relative. If I'm looking at what everything you said from my point of view.
Yes.
For me,
yes.
The streets in Bucharest are so wide that you can drive without a problem. Nobody will kick you. So, and these roundabouts are so huge. But it's probably how to say. It's if you compare two states, I mean, you are 20 million inhabitant states. You are the
sure.
biggest state in a region.
Yes.
And how to say, if you compare then this with the streets, maybe?
Yeah. I was joking with the streets, yeah, but believe me, I was not I was not calm. When I was in the car, I mean, everything was nice, but when I was about to go on the streets, I was not feeling comfortable at all. But besides that, it's a wonderful country, mm-hmm. and it really is worthwhile to visit. Mm-hmm. Before, I mean, we will speak at the end also about why we should go to Croatia. What you would like to tell us mm-hmm. about what is in your heart about Croatia, not only what is in your job description to say about Croatia. I want to ask you several other questions mm-hmm. because now you are a member of the EU. Mm-hmm. You are the last member of the EU. You negotiated for 12 years. Mm-hmm. In my view, I mentioned already, you should have been before, much, much before in the EU. Mm-hmm. But now that you are part of the club, I have to ask you this question because it's normal. How do you feel in this club? Because you entered when now we are almost splitting apart. If we look to Mr. Schulz's declaration, mm-hmm. if we look to what United States intelligence agency made public this week, that Russia is dividing Europe mm-hmm. with funds for different parties against the EU and so on. If I look to Mr. Kaplan, which wrote a very interesting editorial in Wall Street Journal, for me was wow. It was describing very, very in many details mm-hmm. how is EU returning to the ghosts from the past. Okay, coming from this apocalyptic description, mm-hmm. now I'm coming to you and ask, how do you feel as a country member of the EU now in these difficult times?
But look, let's start from the beginning to tell you the fact that a few days ago it was 24th anniversary of Romanian recognition of the independence of the Republic of Croatia. So when you mentioned these times, what we are witnessing now, I'm always keeping my mind times 25 years ago. It was pretty apocalyptic for Croatia
yes,
then,
true.
And unfortunately there was some kind of the scenes what we are now remembering what happened to us 24, 25 years ago. That's the reason maybe we sometimes have a More understanding for the problems of the refugees, the people who are unfortunately fleeing their countries because not of their own will. So, but back to the story of the European Union and the problems, I would say that this is one storm which will pass. Of course, European Union has a bit slower mechanism. And the mechanism of what they are using through the institutions are, it's not affecting immediately. And that's something what is a difference between some other country who has more powerful institutions and, possible for reactions than European Union, because we have to keep in mind we are talking about Union on 28 countries, somehow with a specific interest. Let me tell you, for example, I came here from Vilnius in Lithuania. From the point of view, if you're looking on the problem of the refugees and migration from the north, they are facing completely other type of the refugee from Ukraine.
Yes.
So it's sometimes it's very important to have to spread solidarity over the, all 28 members of the European Union and this type of the awareness that problem is existing. For example, just to mention figures. Till yesterday, through Croatia passed 596,000 refugees. So
almost 600,000.
Almost 600. Today, probably it will be 600,000 in last 3.5 months. So, you know, it's a real problem.
And you didn't complain so much as other
countries. Look, we are at the moment we are not targeting country, but all those people are passing through Croatia. We have to provide them a food, healthcare, and kind of the decent treatment what they deserve and need it as a something what is a kind of the priority, then everything else. Because as I told you, we remember 25 years ago all those problems. Occasionally people are asking me concerning the fact that all those people are from Islamic countries, and I said, look, when we are having a fight for our liberation of our own state, we have two Islam communities in Croatia on our side.
Exactly.
I'm talking about Bosniaks from Bosnia and Herzegovina and Kosovo Albanians.
Yes.
So we have understanding for that. Of course, there will be always this, part of the 1%, or I will not doubt,
of course.
I will not mention the, but you know, with those people you can have also a problem. But this how it goes, unfortunately.
Mr. Ambassador, the 600,000 migrants, they just passed?
Just passed, yes.
Or also stayed?
They just passed, and as I told, we are not targeting country. Most of them would like to
Germany,
and so on. Germany, then Sweden.
Sweden, of course, the Nordic countries.
In Nordic countries. This is what we are facing. It's just few, even maybe less than 20 of them ask for asylum in Croatia and start this classical measure. But okay, we. It's a. After that, there is a you are following the story with Schengen zone.
Of course, unfortunately, I saw Mr. Donald Tusk declaration, which this was very clear, saying yesterday or today, I think, that the Schengen area is almost falling apart. That's why I asked you this question, Mr. Ambassador, because you are an intelligent person and good diplomat, and you know very well the European affairs. You are responsible for European affairs. So, you know, I believe in the EU very much. I believe it's the only project that can Romania have at this moment. United States is good for security, is good for everything, but economically and politically it's too far for us. That's why we need to have this common project. At the same time, I have to look to what is happening and discuss with you. Donald Tusk made a declaration yesterday speaking about the Schengen area falling apart. Mr. Martin Schulz, which is one of the, let's say, most experienced politicians and leaders of the European Union, is speaking about Europe, the EU falling apart. all these apocalyptic images are not created anymore by analysts or us or other people which are reading. No, our officials is the president of the European Council, is the president of the European Parliament, let's say. Is the, all these people are giving these messages, and it's very dangerous for the people of Europe, because they need to believe in the project. That's why I'm asking my guests, okay, we have, how do we convince the people to continue to believe in the EU if these kind of messages are coming from the leaders of the EU?
Allow me to start with this, looking from the Croatian accession process. I very often remember this sentence what we are always repeating to ourselves: there is no alternative for Croatia, European Union. By the way, I was remember that as a sentence what I was listening 35 years ago. There was no alternative to communism. So, so I don't like the fact there is no alternative. Yes. But the fact is that we. It was a kind of the second paradigm for Croatia after the establishing independent state, then enters in European Union, in NATO. It was second priority. Then we achieve it.
Yes.
And then, what now? Then we saw that we enters in a not favorable time for European Union, for internal situation concerning the economic recession, problems with euro, then migration crisis, but then it was a second problem what we have it, how to talk about European Union and European institution as us, not as them.
Yes.
So even maybe yeah. we are making now mistake talking about them, that somebody.
No, I'm including myself in the in the problem.
No, of course, so we have to, take our part. In ideas, in possible solutions, be creative, and to accept the part what was agreed that it will be our part of the way for everything. I was carefully listening priorities of Dutch presidency, and I will stick to the sentence that we have to fulfill everything what we agreed. And this is one thing what is important, and of course, European Union is a union of the regulations, laws, rules, but it's also union of the value. We have to respect our common values. So how to try to find a balance between something what is acceptable, also respecting our, fundamental values of the European Union. By the way, I remember, even if you look into Romania and Croatia, after the joining and European Union and liberating, or how is in European called
free
movement of the labor, there is a lot of Croats and Romanians try to find their happiness and their life abroad. So. You know, let's try to find a measure on that with the common responsibility and taking our own part. Maybe I'm I'm preaching. At the end, you have to put it in a kind of the strict decisions.
Yes. And that's Mr. Master, I like your approach, because it's a positive approach and we really need that. I really strongly believe in the EU project, because I believe that now only the big players can stay at the table. Mm-hmm. We have already coalitions of states in the world, or at least big states playing. Mm-hmm. EU cannot play with the individual states anymore. Mm-hmm. So I agree with you. My problem is, and what is worrying me, and I cannot understand, is why the leaders of the EU itself, the big players, are giving such messages. Because until now were just rumors, people making analysis. The president of the European Parliament, the president of the European Council, ministers, prime ministers, they are speaking about EU falling apart. America is now speaking about Russia dividing Europe. In a way or not, EU must find, as you said, I agree with you, we need to find a solution to communicate to the people, no, the project continues. Because else they are playing with the declarations. I can make the declaration, but I'm not an official, or at least I'm not a prime minister, or the president of the European Council, or an important person in Brussels. If they do this, it's not good for the population.
Look, that's how to say, that's kind of the alert that we have to take some serious measures and how to say, make a serious reconception of the politics and to how to say, draw the line and see what, how far we can go with the project of receiving migration. At the moment, probably I recognize changing of the wording. So yes, probably yes, we are yes, on the edge, yes. And in how I understand, in next few weeks it will be important decision how to treat this crisis, problem and the crisis. Of course, there is a even in naming of the crisis, are we talking about refugees or migration? So slowly we start to making a distinction with those two processes.
It's very important. Yes.
So after that, also, and of course, I think we have to always keep in mind this how to say basic idea: try to treat the problem, source of the problem.
Mr. Ambassador, we will take a short break for commercials, and we will be back. Publicitate.